Hey, Trevor Matthews here. Thank you so much for subscribing to this video newsletter. I hope you had a chance to check out that last email with the free compressor guide. I spent a lot of time investing, taking pictures, writing out what I've found over the years of experience of tearing down, inspecting compressors to really help guide you when you come into a compressor that is not running or it has failed so another one doesn't fail. If you haven't had a chance to look at it, I'm going to break them down step by step. We're going to go through overheat in this video, okay? The biggest causes of overheat and the biggest one is compression ratio. When I was a technician in the field, I did not know or look to check compression ratio. I heard about it in school and that was about it. When I was in the field, I did not ever check about compression ratio, but compression ratio is the largest failure of overheat, compression ratio. That is the biggest one. Then we have high superheat, we have high return gas, we have external cooling or cool gas not coming back. These are the things that are causing compressors to fail for overheat or start to have issues and start tripping off your internal overload. So let's get into it. What is compression ratio? Okay, compression ratio is absolute discharge over absolute suction. How do you calculate that? So you take your gauge pressure, and you add absolute to it. So here's a quick example. We have 275 PSI. We add 15 PSI to it, absolute, which is really 14.7, but I make 15 as an easy calculation, which equals 290. So on our suction side, we have 55 PSI. We add 15 PSI, which is really supposed to be 14.7, but add 15 is 70. So our compression ratio is 4.1 to 1, okay? If we do this in bar, 19 bar, plus absolute, which is one bar, close to one bar, and then that's 20 bar absolute, and then we have four bar and a suction plus one equals five bar absolute. Now we have a 4-to-1 compression ratio. Okay, so this is what you would check with your gauges. But when you start to run into issues, you have high compression ratios, high heat and high work. So let's take a quick look at an issue problem. So we have an increase of 60 PSI in the discharge, okay? Your condenser's plugged or your fan's not working properly erratically. So you have that high discharge pressure. Okay, so now we have our discharge, which we had 290 PSIA. We add 60 to it. Now that's 350 PSIA. Absolute again. Our suction doesn't change, we'll say, on this example. Now we have 70 PSIA, and that will equal to 5-to-1 compression ratio. We're probably fine. We're probably still inside the operation envelope of that compressor, but that is something you need to make sure of. You need to check from that compressor manufacturer if you're still inside that operation envelope. Okay, so 5-to-1 is not too bad. So now let's look at a suction pressure drop of 60 PSI. So exact same pressure pressure rating from the high side to the low side. So, but we got a 60 PSI pressure drop in the suction. So our discharge stays the same, 290 PSIA, but we take 70 PSIA, subtract 60 PSI. Now we're down to 10 PSIA. 290 PSIA over 10 PSIA is 29-to-1 compression ratio. That's going to start tripping off the internals. It's going to be running really hot. You're going to run into a lot of issues. So you need to understand that pressure drop into suction is way worse than increase in discharge pressure. So if you have suction filter dryers in there, if you have anything that could restrict the low side and the suction side and start having a pressure drop, you're going to run into major issues. Okay, things you need to check, and these are checks you need to do every time you're troubleshooting a service, is that discharge line check, 6 inches or 150 mils from that compressor service valve, so important. You want to stay below 225 or 107C because inside the head of that semi-hermetic compressor, it's running 50 to 75 degrees Fahrenheit hotter. So you're running a lot hotter right where it's discharging, right from that valve. So you want to make sure you want to check and it stays below 225 or 107, because if not, you're getting into a range where oil starts to lose lubrication when it gets hotter than that. Then it starts to break down to oil and then you run into a world of hurt. Something you also need to know, for every degree you increase that suction line, you increase a degree in the discharge. So if you have higher or hotter gas coming back, or you have where you're picking up heat, for this example here, you have your suction line not insulated, or it runs through a hot attic and your insulation's broke down because that happens over the years, 20 years, 10 years, that insulation starts to break down and then you get infiltration and then it starts to pick up the heat. So what you want to do is a good check would be check at the outlet of your evaporator, what's your suction line temperature, and then what is it at the inlet of that compressor? What is the difference? How much temperature drop do you have in that whole range? So you always want to inspect that and check that suction line. And make sure that you always insulate the suction line. Okay, next thing for overheat. Overheat starts to cause wear on your pistons, your cylinders, your rings. So in semi-hermetic compressor, as it's compressing and you have ring wear, piston wear, cylinder wear, it compresses, but it pushes discharge gas into the crank. And inside the crank here, there is a little check valve. So as this pressure starts to push down in here, every time it compresses and pushes down, it closes what we call this oil check valve, because this oil check valve helps oil go this way. Here's a vent valve that actually puts a little extra pressure in the body of the compressor so that oil can flow. But if we got pressure blowing by here and closing that, all of a sudden this fills up with oil and then you go off on your oil failure control. I've had this happen to me in the field. I didn't even know that it happened to me. I only figured this out after I started working for a compressor manufacturer, and I've seen it over and over again. So if you have nuisance trips, you call them, on your oil failure control, they're not really nuisance trips. There's something going on either with your oil management system or there's something going on with that compressor, and it could be blow-by. How do you do a blow-by check? Very important. You need two low-pressure gauges. You need to put one on the crank, right on the crank of the body, where your pistons are, as well as one on your suction line, so your suction service valve. And what you start to do is to shut the suction service valve slowly and watch those gauges start to drop. They'll drop and then it'll just pump down. But if you have blow by, what'll happen as you start to close that suction service valve, they'll start to drop, 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 drop. All of a sudden, the crank one here will rise back up because that pressure is pushing back down from that compression happening. Now you have blow by. Now you want to pull off the heads and look inside to see if you got wear, ring wear, piston wear, or cylinder wear. One other thing that could cause that is your oil management blowing gas inside there, but a lot of the times it is a damaged compressor. So some of the things that you need to know and understand is that you always want to stay inside the compression ratio per manufacturer design. I have two different manufacturers here. These are the operation envelopes of them. So you can't go outside that. When you start to go outside them, you start to run into issues, overheat issues, flood backs, flooded starts, things that we'll talk over the next few weeks. Other things you need to want to make sure, you want to always stay inside this envelope, but you also, as you can see here, DTC, liquid injection required in this one. This blue area here means you need some sort of cooling for that compressor right here. So additional cooling methods are very important. Then that helps prevent overheat. You never want to set the low pressure control outside this range here. So as we can see, if we set the low pressure control right to here, we're going to be running outside every time that compressor pumps down or that system pumps down. We're running outside, and if it's a long period of running outside, you could run into issues. A short period running outside the envelope is not so bad, but if it runs, and it doesn't pump down right away, you're causing work, causing heat, which is going to lead to a quicker failure. Very important. Last thing that you need to know about overheating, you always need to check the compressor superheat. What should the compressor superheat be? It should be 20 degrees Fahrenheit or 11K. That's a good number for most manufacturers. There is some play. If you're running at 15 degrees Fahrenheit superheat, oh, you're fine. You know, if you're running at, you know, say 9K, you're probably okay. But when you start to get 0 degrees superheat, or no superheat at all, that's when you start to have an issue. And this is how you check it. You take a temperature probe, you put it, at right close to the compressor on the suction line. You also take the suction pressure. And then what you do is you convert that SST, that pressure, into a temperature. So you take your suction line temperature, this example is 22 Fahrenheit, and then you take your pressure temperature, which is 2 degrees Fahrenheit, which you get 20K. If you're doing it in Celsius, so we have -6 Celsius, and then we did 1.8 bar, converted into your SST, we got -17, we got 11K. So that's what you need to check. Make sure you're checking that compressor superheat, because this is one of the things that we see time and time again causing overheat, high return gas temperature. I hope you enjoyed this video. I've put a link below the video. If you have any friends you think will benefit from the compressor troubleshooting guide, just tell them, click the link below, enter their name and email address, and they'll get that free compressor guide as well as these free videos. I hope you enjoyed this overheat video. My name is Trevor Matthews. Let's get a conversation going.